said, "Man, how do you listen to stuff? It's really scary." And I said, "You know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends."
This is why in 2 Corinthians, Paul says that he's afraid for the Christians, because eventually there's going to come false teachers in the end times. They're going to be teaching a false gospel and a false Jesus.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
All right, we'll go ahead and get started. As usual, we have a morning announcement. Everyone prepare for, so it's not this Friday, but the next Friday will be our Passover celebration, 4/22, so April 22nd, and it will be at 6:30 p.m. It'll be really exciting. It sounds like we're going to have a really good turnout if all the numbers show up that we already have. We'll probably be packed in here. Hope you guys are planning to come. It'll be really cool, really exciting.
Gentlemen, it's not too late to start growing out your Passover beards.
Yeah, that's what these are
this
for.
This is the only time you'll ever see a beard on my face, so it's Passover.
So now you have 12 days to grow a sweet Passover beard. You'll feel more Jewish.
Curly sideburns are optional.
Yeah. Anyone who has a sweet Jewish beard gets a free prayer shawl. Okay, we got some prophecy in the headlines today. We haven't done this in a while, so I was wondering if Jesus wasn't coming back or what. But now we got a real news story here. And this has been coming back to me multiple times. I tried to like avoid it because I didn't really know if it was a true story. It's so hard in today's kind of world knowing whether or not news stories are real or verified. So I always try to verify the stuff I put up here, especially if you're looking at it in light of Bible prophecy. Because as you know, a lot of people get extremely carried away with some of the things that are going on in our world today. But this is really happening, and this is a true story. I've verified it, and I'll continue to follow it as it goes. This was from the New York Times. It's an article called Life Among the Ruins, but what's happening is they're recreating the Temple of Baal. I don't know if you guys are familiar with what happened in the news. ISIS kind of overtook Palmyra. They destroyed all these ancient artifacts. And because they're destroying all these ancient artifacts, you have all these world corporations that are now wanting to recreate these artifacts as kind of a keepsake of human history and kind of put them up in museums all around the world. But what's interesting is they're recreating the Temple of Baal, and they're putting them in, it's going to come to Times Square. Next month, the Temple of Baal will come to Times Square. Reproductions of the 50-foot arch that formed the temple's entrance are to be installed in New York and London, a tribute to the 2,000-year-old structure that the Islamic State destroyed last year in the Syrian town of Palmyra. So, once again, isn't this kind of interesting that now we're in Thyatira, and if you guys remember back months ago when we talked about Jezebel and her religion that we discussed from the ancient Israelite times, they worshipped Baal and Asherah. It's just kind of crazy that when you think about it, this is kind of an arch that has been passed on, or this religion is that mystery religion, that mystery Babylonian religion that we've talked about that goes all the way back to the Tower of Babel. We are literally seeing a recreation of this Temple of Baal in New York and London. Once again, here's just a little highlighted thing that I think is interesting. It will be uncanny and thrilling to see this arch from an ancient desert civilization set against the bright lights of New York. Isn't it amazing, though, that people read that and say, oh, that's cute. But if you think about it, these temples of Baal were places of child sacrifice. They were places of ritual orgy. They were places of just crazy demonic things. And we in our world today think that this is going to be kind of a good thing to place in New York City and London when if you actually research it. And if you believe in spiritual aspects of things, who knows what kind of spiritual things are opened up when you recreate places of worship for false idols, for false demons. So just something for you to watch. Once again, this is just kind of relating. The article continues on talking about why people want this to be recreated. But it's interesting that this temple of Baal that was destroyed in Palmyra, which over the centuries had been transformed into a Byzantinian church, then a mosque, before eventually becoming part of the village, and then ISIS destroyed it. The reason I highlight this is because this is kind of a picture of the Thyatira church age that we're kind of watching. All that the church would do at this time is they would kind of retake these pagan temples and make them into a church. Imagine if there was a Baal worship center and we said, oh, well, we're Christians. We're just going to move in and we're going to put up pictures of Jesus and stuff. That was kind of what the church at this time did. I probably wouldn't do that myself, but it's just kind of interesting for us to see this all come in full circle to today. So keep that on your radar. I think that they said it's happening on April 19th, which I don't get too carried away, but supposedly that's a big occult holiday. It's one of the most crazy occult holidays of the year. So
I personally just think it's one of those things where you don't see the actual implications of it right away on the surface, but the spiritual implications are huge because these literally, it's like they used ISIS to tear down, you know, the original temple, but then they erect two in London and New York. And these cities are already notorious because of St. Peter's Basilica. And then you have, you know, on the East Coast, you also have Washington, D.C. You see these, you know, mirror images all the time of our East Coast versus London. And these are basically just, you know, what we would think of as like spiritual gates, spiritual porters. And what are they actually being used for? You know, but they're, you know, they use the guise of a, you know, it's just archaeology. It's just human history. It's just, you know, something that we put in a museum, look at and go, cool. But the players behind the scenes really actually know what these things are for. And they're purposely putting them there for they have spiritual implications, things that the public won't see. But what us with spiritual eyes know, okay, there's something really deep going on here.
Absolutely. And is it interesting that London, America, the United States, we kind of run the world financially. So once again, just something to think about. So real quick, by means of review, last week we talked about Thomas Aquinas and the seven sacraments. We really covered penance, the doctrine of penance, and the doctrine of indulgences, which both basically are a way to pay for your sins on earth. Penance is where you kind of repent and you go before a priest and you say, I'm sorry, and then you have to do certain steps to receive forgiveness from a priest of punishment here on earth or purgatory punishment. And also we talked quickly about indulgences, which indulgences were things that the church at this time began to sell and or give out in exchange for land where you could lessen your time of paying for your sins on earth or even for your relatives. You could actually pay for them to not spend as much time in purgatory. So once again, you can kind of see how that could easily be corrupted. Last week we saw Pope Boniface versus the kings of France and England. Long story short, the marriage of the Pope and the kings that was so cool in the beginning, now nearly 1,000 years later, we're kind of seeing that they don't like each other anymore. And that's just what I kind of wanted you guys to see there. We're seeing the separation of church and state. Finally, the Babylonian captivity of the popes, which means that Rome was always the seat of headquarters for the popes, but there was a big schism and the headquarters moved to France, Avignon, France. Long story short there, it was kind of a dirty deal. They fought back and forth, but eventually there was a pope that went back to Rome, but that wasn't without controversy because you literally had two popes fighting over who really is the true pope. And not only that, we had a third pope thrown into the mix, and they were all excommunicating each other, fighting each other, which led to the Great Papal Schism. So an interesting time in church history. But needless to say, I'm saying all that stuff because what we are beginning to see in human history during this time is that the Roman Catholic Church is finally beginning to lose power that it had for nearly 1,000 years ruling mankind. So we're going to look at some more aspects of that moving forward today. We should get all the way through to 1500 today if I speak really fast. So let's pray and get going.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you so much for the ability to just meet here and study your word. We just ask that you open up our hearts and lives to your word so we can become more and better stewards of the opportunities that you give us, Father. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let me check something real quick here. Still good. Okay, we'll get started. Got a nice little... So our next entry here, studying church history, we're going to talk about the Black Death. Anybody studied the Black Plague ever? Just maybe briefly heard about it? We'll check this out, and maybe you guys will see it in a different light.
The plague is first documented on the Black Sea in 1347. And it's Mongols who seem to bring the plague.
The Silk Road became a superhighway for disease.
Coming out of Central Asia, across the plains, were different intersecting parts of the Silk Road. Traveling with the caravans were rats. Traveling with the rats were fleas. Traveling with the fleas in the sort of the intestines of the fleas were parasites. And that's how plague made its first entrance with trade goods from the east into the Mediterranean world.
In the Middle Ages, plague spread maybe about 2 kilometers per day by land routes, and it also spread by shipping routes to major ports. The plague was devastating as it made a relentless march from Italy across to France, Spain, Portugal, up to England, and then as it continued to make its way north up to Germany and to the Netherlands. These cities had all the conditions to sustain plague, the filth, the squalor, and then you had this massive number of people all packed together in these small dwellings, and it was the exact sort of situation you would want if you were trying to cause a plague epidemic.
This plague was an absolute horror for our species. Roughly two-thirds of the population of Europe was simply eliminated. The world would seem as though it were coming to an end.
People start turning to the church to ask for the hand of God, and it strikes priests and bishops and clerics just as much as it strikes others. Civil law broke down. There was no way to administer a city in these conditions. It was mass hysteria and mass fear.
At the end of the day, although the plague is an absolutely horrible condition, it sets the stage for new thinking.
The plague had a deep effect on human civilization because the structure of society changed.
The feudal society has broken down. People who once were peasants can now possibly become merchants.
History is so fundamentally changed by the plague. I would make the argument that disease is probably one of the few greatest forces of human history.
Okay. So... have you guys ever thought about how crazy of a time that would have been to live? Literally 2 out of every 3 people just dying in the majority of what is the known world. That would be a pretty crazy time to exist. So let's talk about some implications of the Black Death. Some of the things that were mentioned in that video, it helped bring about an end to feudalism. Okay, I over the last week, I've tried to study a lot of feudalism, and you could spend a lot of time really trying to break this down, but I'm going to try to keep it as simple as possible. But just so you know, we live in basically a capitalistic society right now. For nearly 1,000 years over in the known world, what they ruled and lived by was a system of feudalism. Basically, it's based on hierarchy. It's kind of like a pyramid, chain of command, and those in the pyramid, they benefit each other. Some, like a king, would provide land, he would give land to a nobleman who was basically a really rich noble guy. That nobleman would have knights who would protect him, who would protect the king. And at the very bottom of the totem pole, you have what are called serfs, who are basically glorified slaves who were just basically working for food. The people were born into this system. So what really stinks about this system, see, we kind of live in a society today what we would call capitalism. where you can kind of, in a way, create your own destiny, right? You can kind of work as hard as you want, possibly move your way up. In this society, you were literally born in your state of affairs. You were born, if you were born a peasant, you weren't getting out of being a peasant. If you were born a nobleman, you were rich, okay? So what's unfortunate about this system is we know that really corrupt people continued to be born, and they would just continue to maintain their power. Not only were the noblemen just of noble family, noble birth, but even in the church, if you were a clergyman or a bishop, you were literally born into that priest class. So there's never, it was all by birth, is what I'm trying to say. So people were born into this system. There was little or no hope out, and the people at the bottom literally had no rights, no education, no nothing. So a lot of this stuff I'm teaching you guys about doctrine, imagine these people had little to no education. So you can kind of see how those in a feudalistic society, like kings and popes and noblemen, can kind of control the masses down at the bottom. They can literally rule their lives, and they can kind of tell them whatever they want. And for the most part, peasants and slaves will do it. So it's a really terrible way to run a society. It's basically slavery, and it's basically a trap. So, I know it's kind of grim to think about, but the Black Death actually was one of the factors that broke that. So in a way, it ended up kind of breaking some of the power of the Roman Catholic Church at that time, and it also broke kind of the power of the really rich kings of France and England and Europe and so on and so forth. So in a way, and that's kind of what they're alluding to in the video, it was kind of a good thing. I know you would that would be kind of hard to see, but in all reality, a lot of these peasants, what happened was it literally destroyed that whole system because there was so much death that you no longer had peasants who could work all the fields and work all the land. So everybody just basically started going bankrupt, which is actually a good thing because then these peasants now had to, or they had to recreate a whole new system, and now these peasants actually became merchants and they could find ways to kind of crawl out of that feudalistic society. So it was a serious blow to the Roman Catholic Church. And of course, the Roman Catholic Church and, you know, those that were in power still want to maintain power. They didn't just give up. So it resulted in more widespread persecution within Europe at that time. And what's funny is you go back and you study human history, Satan always gets his two cents in, but it's always the Jews who's at fault, right? There was especially widespread persecution of the Jews at this time because, of course, if the plague is now spreading and they don't know what it is, so it had to have been the Jews that brought it over. So let's wipe the Jews out. And we'll see the reasons why down the road as we study why Satan wants to attack and kill the Jews. Many historians see a cause and effect relationship between Black Death and the Renaissance. So as we talked really briefly last week, the Renaissance is what we would call the scientific revolution. They said that it kind of changed mankind's thinking. It kind of changed the paradigm. So not only, remember last week we talked about the world is getting fed up with the church at this time. They're getting fed up with the church saying you have to do this, you have to follow this, or you're excommunicated, blah, blah, blah. Mankind was getting tired of that. Now the mankind sees literally two out of every three people die, and as this video was saying, they're turning to God. They're saying, God, how can this happen, right? How are you allowing this to happen? So now we kind of see mankind thinking, maybe we don't need God, okay? Maybe there's something else. You kind of get this scientific revolution. Maybe we just focus on science. Let's get behind the science of things and what we will call liberal humanism. So we're going to kind of see that paradigm shift because of certain aspects of history, and Black Death was a big contribution to that. People were done with God at this point, okay? In one way or another, people were fed up with God. So as I said, this improved the situation of the living peasants. Okay, you good? Okay. So that concludes the Black Death. Now we're going to finish up with some last key events. Okay, I found this interesting. I wanted to show you guys. There is literally, if you study human history, there is what we will call a cycle of nations. Okay, all nations kind of go through a certain cycle. And if you really look at the top of the circle and the bottom of the circle. So let's just say the top of the circle represents freedom. Okay, you have freedom, you have abundance, you have things. The bottom of the circle there represents bondage. If you really study human history, you'll see that mankind is always in this cycle. And what's kind of interesting, and we're not necessarily going to do it today, but you can kind of, as I go over these, you can kind of think about where is America today, okay? But as a country or as a group of people has an abundance, eventually what happens is they grow complacent, okay? Doesn't really matter, doesn't really affect them what's going on around them. As long as I got mine, you know, I got all my stuff, I'm good to go, right? They're just complacent. You just kind of don't pay attention to what's going on behind the scenes. Complacency eventually leads to apathy. Apathy means I don't care. Go ask 9 out of 10 people out on the streets and say, hey, well, okay, I guess I can't say 9 out of 10, but go ask them, hey, do you guys care what's going on in America today? That a lot of your freedoms are being taken away, that a lot of so on and so forth, and most of them be like, eh, I don't really care. That's apathy, right? So people don't even realize that when you're in a system that your freedoms are being taken away, usually as long as you have some stuff, you're apathetic. That's why we are brainwashed into just caring about our TV, our sports events, our music, our so on and so forth. Just kind of keep the main population dumb and let those big people in power kind of continue to take freedom. Unfortunately, that's the way human history is kind of replayed out. After you're apathetic, then all your freedoms begin to be taken away and you grow into a state of dependency. So now these people that are in power have kind of taken away all of your rights, all of your stuff, and you grow dependent on a higher entity, for instance, government, that is going to provide everything for you. As you can kind of see in today's society, we have a lot of people who want America, a majority of America, to be dependent on bigger government, okay? So those, and we don't have to get into political debates, but those in the political left believe that humans should be more dependent on government, and government should take care of the people. Unfortunately, those of us with a more conservative mindset know that, unfortunately, corrupt people can't handle that kind of power, and we can never truly fully depend on government to kind of maintain everything and take really good care of everybody. That's just never worked in human history, but maybe this time will be different. So they go to a state of dependency, and unfortunately, as humans become dependent on a bigger government, they enter what's called bondage. Unfortunately, as I said, when humans get under a set of government, what does government do? They take more and more and more and more. Unfortunately, in this utopian society that people want, you can't government just give everybody everything and we all just live peacefully, sing kumbaya, hold hands. Doesn't work. Unfortunately, that big government is going to continue to take and take and take. And they're going to take all of your freedoms, and they're going to take all of your reading materials, and they're going to maintain and drive you down a certain path they want. This is demonic, and this is what Lucifer does. He takes over, and he wants to keep mankind enslaved. So, from that bondage, then eventually people will look around and say, hey, man, we're trapped. This stinks, right? And then spiritual faith will grow. You'll say, man, there's got to be something bigger than this. I got to get out of this system. And we're going to kind of look at this here. But from that spiritual faith grows courage. Okay. And once again, now you're kind of seeing like the formation of America, right? You're kind of seeing that men during that time, this church history time that we're talking about here, they were tired of being in bondage. Now they're starting to get some faith, and we're going to see some courage. And when a lot of people raise up with spiritual courage, with God in their back, they take action, right? They fight. And they get that liberty that we all so badly want, that free will, that human rights. And eventually that liberty leads to a good society where all people, you kind of get to choose your own path. As long as you're not infringing with others, you kind of do your own thing, and we can grow to a nation of abundance. So that is the cycle of nations. Isn't that kind of interesting? Have you guys ever seen that before? So in your own spare time, you can kind of pick and choose and figure out where is America in that. Did you have anything? But we'll talk about that some other day. But as for now, I want you guys to see this time in church history, or in human history, the church has a lot of power, and they basically, as we saw with this system of feudalism, basically mankind is kind of enslaved to this Catholic Church, this European feudalist society. They're kind of enslaved. And so what happens when people are enslaved? We're going to see some bright lights in spiritual faith. I always say, and you guys know this true, light shines brightest in the darkness. We have an opportunity in America today. As we continue to see things grow darker and darker in the world around us, you as a Christian, your light should shine even more. Okay, your light's going to get offensive to some people. I get it. But as the world continues to darken, you need to shine brighter. For instance, so now in our time in church history here, we see this light beginning to shine. We see people, key people, who have shaped literally you and I sitting in our church pews today, and you don't even know it, a guy named John Wycliffe. Perhaps some of you guys have read a Bible that says the Wycliffe Bible. This is one of the original Bible translators at this time. Gosh darn it. He's cute, though. You want to see that picture twice anyway. So here's our guy. So let's talk about John Wycliffe. He was a leading philosopher. He was a theologian. He was a Bible translator. And once again, isn't it kind of interesting? He just believed that the common man should be able to read the Bible for himself. Once again, the Catholic Church believed that only the clergy, only those super spiritual men born into nobility should be able to read the Bible. So the common man is just dumb, and they're just supposed to take the Pope and the clergy's word for it, okay? But not this guy. This guy began to translate the Bible behind the church's back to really get this Bible out to common man so they could break free from the system that was created. He would be considered a forerunner for the Reformation. So as I'm saying, sitting here, we in heaven, we will thank John Wycliffe for his efforts. And we will say, John, you were a man with great...
Spiritual.
Yes. Spiritual something. Valor. There you go. He was a forerunner for the Reformation. He believed the Pope and the Church were second in authority to the Bible itself. That's a big key distinction, guys. The Church believed that the Pope was the final authority. The traditions of men were the final authority. The hierarchy of the Church was the final authority, not this guy. He says the Bible is, and that's what we live by. We live by these 66 books. And John Wycliffe was one of the guys that brought that to us. He wrote against transubstantiation. He challenged indulgences and purgatory, repudiated private confession, clung firmly to salvation by grace through faith, and spoke against the existence of the papacy itself. So you can kind of see this guy's probably going to be in a lot of trouble within the Catholic Church at this time. But as we already said, the Catholic Church has lost a lot of power. So this guy is actually able to survive and to continue to preach all this stuff. He spoke out against the privileged clergy and the pomp of the state church. He rejected the concept of purgatory, disapproved of celibacy, taught against praying to the saints. He was officially declared a heretic on 260 accounts. And as we said, when you're declared a heretic, you're officially dead to the church. But what's interesting is this happened in 1415 at the Council of Constance. He had already been dead for 31 years. So what does the Catholic Church do? They decide to take him out of his grave. They grind his bones just to make sure that the world gets this guy as a heretic. They grind his bones and they throw it in the river Swift. So his writings were to be destroyed. They wanted to destroy all of his writings. They wanted to destroy all the translations of the Bible because, once again, they don't want mankind to be able to read that Bible. Well, I'm blown away when I read the Bible. I'm in awe. Guys, we have a miracle sitting at our fingertips every day that we can read it. I promise you, if history continues to repeat itself, we won't be able to read the Bible. It's the human history repeating itself. Satan does not want mankind to realize the freedom that is within those 66 books. So, his ashes were cast into the River Swift. So a chronicler of that time said they burnt his bones to ashes and cast them into the River Swift, a neighboring brook running hard by. Thus the brook has conveyed his ashes into Avon, Avon to Severn, Severn into the narrow seas, and they into the main ocean. And thus the ashes of John Wycliffe are the emblem of his doctrine, which now is dispersed the world over. This guy was basically kind of saying, the Catholic Church, you can grind his bones, you throw it in the river. You were basically prophetically saying, this guy's teachings are now going to spread throughout the world. And in fact, that's exactly what happens. He is a forerunner of the Reformation. He's a forerunner of what's to come. And actually, his mantle was picked up by this scholarly looking sweet dude with a beard. His name was John Huss, another light shining in the darkness. He is a Czech priest. Czech priest who picked up Wycliffe's mantle. He painstakingly copied Wycliffe's works as most people were trying to destroy it. He copied them, kept them going. His main preaching was against indulgences. And once again, the Catholic Church is in a state where they've lost all their money. They've lost a lot of their power. So they're really scrambling to try to get money. And one of the ways they really try to scramble and get money was to sell these indulgences. And we'll talk a little bit more about that here in a second. But the selling of indulgence. This guy, John Huss, said Jesus alone was the head of the church. Not a pope. Not a vicar of Christ. Jesus alone is the head of the church. He claimed only God can forgive sins. Isn't that interesting? Not a priest class. You don't have to go and do certain things and ask for forgiveness. Only God can forgive your sins. Yeah, the Catholic Church. Oh, so what happens to John Huss? Interesting, if you research history, they literally trapped him. So the church trapped him. They said, hey, you come meet with us. We'll talk this over. Everything will work out. But it was all a lie. They got him in there, and basically he found himself a victim of the Inquisition. He was burned at the stake. Okay. What's interesting is he goes, they still were trying to get him to confess, say, hey, you're a heretic. Tell the world that you're lying. Tell the world that John Wycliffe was a heretic, and he wouldn't all the way to his grave. He said, God is my witness that the evidence against me is false. I have never thought nor preached except with the one intention of winning men, if possible, from their sins. Today I will gladly die. And shortly after, he was burned at the stake. Those were his last words. So, summarizing here, finally, we're going to get through our last key events here. We're actually going to make it all the way through, like I told you. So, 1453, we finally see what's called the fall of Constantinople, which Constantinople was basically the imperial capital of Europe since Constantine in 330. This was kind of like the last bastion, the real big headquarters of the church. I think I have a video for you here. Pardon the sound quality.
The fall of Constantinople was an enormous event, but both symbolic and reasons. This was the capital of a huge branch of Christianity. And so for Christians in Western Europe, their identity has been taken over by the bad guys. So you have this symbolic, devastating loss. But then you also had these practical economic consequences, and suddenly now there's a new tollkeeper who jacked up the prices, and so spices, silk, porcelain, and other, you know, exotic luxury goods, the prices went way up.
And what this turns into is a great desire on the part of Europe to expand the sea routes in order to reestablish trade in such a way that the Turks could not interfere. If you think about it, the fall of Constantinople has a direct correlation to Columbus coming to America. How is this? Because Columbus was looking for the Indies. He's looking to reestablish the shortest possible route to regain what had been lost in the East with the Ottoman Empire blocking the way.
What's clear is that the story would have turned out dramatically differently if Constantinople hadn't fallen.
Okay, so fall of Constantinople. Once again, isn't it amazing that little things like that shape our history? As they were saying, Christopher Columbus eventually set sail after that, and you could get into the whole study. Studying the Christopher Columbus is really fascinating. Some historians say he was a Jew, right? And if you read a lot of his material, he definitely was a Christian. I mean, he talked a lot about Jesus, and he believed he was on a divine destiny to find this land over here. But that's a study for another day. You guys can research that on your own. It's very, very interesting. But continuing on with church history, just a couple last little bullet points here. In 1512, Michelangelo, by the authority of the Pope, he completed the Sistine Chapel. How many of you guys have heard of the Sistine Chapel? We all know about the Sistine Chapel. It's this really... As I've studied art history, and T. Hood was an art dude, many historians say that this is literally the pinnacle of mankind's artistic ability, was this guy. This guy, Michelangelo, was divinely inspired to art. Do you have anything?
What's crazy, guys, is there's so much packed into those paintings that you would never even understand, like, the picture of God reaching out and touching Adam is actually a map of the human brain. And there's things in there that you would never see, that you could just study, like Google Michelangelo's art and the, I guess, almost like the esoteric implications and things that, like, he could paint on the ceiling of the chapels, like images that were of like major galaxies and supernovas, and they overlap perfectly. It's like, how did he know these things? How did he see these things? Like, it's really creepy and it's really bizarre. But the just the way that he painted the ceiling, just the way they hoisted him up, and what his body physically went through in order to the punishment, the physical pain that he would have to endure to complete that work is unbelievable. It's, you know, if you study art history at all, it's not only is it the most beautiful paintings, the most beautiful art, you know, mankind has ever painted, but the, like, what he went through to paint it, like, if you were put in that position, you'd be drawing stick figures, get me down, I don't, you know what I mean? It's just incredible. It's absolutely mind-blowing.
It'll be cool to see if Michelangelo was a Christian or not.
Yeah.
He's definitely divine.
Yeah, but it calls into question how he could see these these things that, you know, exist in our universe, like that he embeds in these paintings. I don't know how he would do it. It's creepy.
So, completed that. And once again, this is very interesting. I just bring out some highlights that are pertinent to our study in Thyatira. What's interesting is in the Sistine Chapel, so Michelangelo paints a lot of biblical scenes, but what's really interesting is if you really study a lot of his works of art, there is a lot of paganism in the works of art that he did. For instance, you'll have 6 Old Testament prophets. You'll have Ezekiel, Jonah, so on and so forth. He'll paint these, but then all of a sudden you'll see, and this is all documented stuff, I'm not making this up, he'll have sibyls in there. So he has the Persian sibyl. He has a Erythrean sibyl. He has a Delphic sibyl, which there is a little caption here. The Delphic Sibyl is one of the better known works in the series of prophets. She is the oracle at the navel of the world, reputed to be descended from the sea god Poseidon and sister of Apollo. So as you begin to study this stuff, you're like, what in the world is this doing in a building that is supposed to be inspired and to the God of the Bible? These oracles and these sibyls have no place being in this building, the Cumaean sibyl.
Are you going to touch on the toes?
Well, I was thinking about throwing it in there for fun, but hold on.
Both of them have it.
Huh?
Both of them have it.
Well, yeah. What's interesting, okay, just on a side note, and T-Hood's taking me on a rabbit trail here, but we don't have a lot of time to spend it, but look at the hand of this picture here. You'll notice that if you count the digits of the hand there, the one on the outside that is holding the Bible, you'll count 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you'll see the spot for the pinky that's kind of hidden there. Do you guys see that? If you superimpose that and kind of look at the other hand, you'll realize that the Cumaean sibyl has a thumb too. So what's interesting is if you kind of count this, this art form has 6 fingers.
And 6 toes, and so does the other one. Look how big they are. Do you remember what it said about the Old Testament giants? The half fallen angels, half humans, 6 toes, 6 fingers. You know, and look how big she is.
So,
just interesting.
Yeah, just a little side note for you. I don't really necessarily, I mean, it's there. There's definitely there. It's kind of hidden there once again. It's kind of cryptic, but
and
6 fingers.
These insights that Michelangelo had are crazy.
Crazy. But my point being is, what are these sibyls? Who, remember, we studied sibyls when we were talking about Jezebel. Remember, there's this chick at Thyatira who claims to be a prophetess who's speaking on behalf of God. A sibyl was a woman who prophesied while in a state of frenzy under the supposed inspiration of a deity. When we studied this, we realized that a sibyl was probably under demonic possession. Okay, so once again, I just kind of bring this to your attention. What is stuff like this doing in the Sistine Chapel? What are there other gods and goddesses of mythology doing mixed in with the Catholic Church's art and stuff like that? And we'll talk about some of the implications of that as we fast forward here and wrap up. But isn't that interesting? Michelangelo completes the Sistine Chapel. I'm going to wrap up here. I got one more minute. You guys still with me? We're finishing up. So this is it. October 31st, 1517. Notice our church history top of the slide there. It says our church history is from 600 to 1517 AD. Many who hold to this historical prophetic view that I'm talking about believe this is officially the end of the Thyatiran church age, because it was when Luther posted his 95 theses in rebuttal to the Catholic Church. He basically listed out 95 reasons why the Catholic Church is wrong on doctrine. Okay, and really quick, we talked about the doctrine of the indulgence. This was the main thing that led Luther to say, I've had enough. This is it. Okay, it was Pope Leo's indulgence that led to partly to the transfer or to the Reformation. Leo commissioned a guy named Friar Tetzel to sell indulgences which promised freedom to family in purgatory or freedom from personal purgatory. He had a famous sales pitch saying, Brooks, don't use this. Brooks has got all kinds of sales pitches. But this guy would go around and say, he would hold his little coin coffer out here, and he would say, as soon as the coin in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs. And once again, now don't you guys kind of see the bigger picture? In a feudalistic society, you have hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of just really poor people that have no education. You can see why they can corrupt, they can take money from these people, and people be like, okay, yeah, I'm down, right? They would literally take these people's entire life savings. Here's a picture of the friar, and people are begging for forgiveness of their sins and begging for forgiveness of their family's sins. You can see how be I so non-politically correct, disgusting this is. Okay, this was a disgusting time in human history. So disgusting that Martin Luther branches an entire new, it's a Protestant Reformation. He says, I'm done with this. You guys are a product of the Protestant Reformation.
Protestant meaning protest. The word protest. Protestant itself, when you hear Protestant, we're a Protestant denomination. Protestant means protest. We're protesting against the doctrines of the Roman Catholic system.
So what's interesting, by the way, is we now live in a world where even many in evangelical Protestant Christianity are saying, hey, let's just all join hands and sing Kumbaya with the Catholic Church. Which, once again, don't get me wrong, do I love Catholics? Absolutely. But do we really need to discuss some of the doctrinal issues that we still have? Yes, because the doctrinal issues are still there. They still hold to the seven sacramental system. So if I was going to join hands, and I can join hands in a lot of different ways, but I would still need to hash out doctrinal issues. So, among other things, they, and this is talking about the 95 Theses, argued that indulgences cannot remove guilt, do not apply to purgatory, and are harmful because they induce a false sense of security in the donor. That was the spark that ignited the Reformation. So there you go. Luther rejected five out of the seven sacraments. So remember, we studied those seven sacraments. Luther officially rejected five of them, said, nope, not biblical. He did keep baptism and communion, which we'll talk about later in Sardis. He still believed in infant baptism. I was actually baptized Lutheran, so I'm an expert on this subject. And they kept communion. They did change communion a little bit. The Catholic Church follows what's called transubstantiation. The Lutheran Church follows what's called consubstantiation, which we'll talk about that later, because I know you guys are nerded out to learn some more doctrine theology, right? So that actually concludes that time in church history. By way of review, next week we'll give a little summary here and we'll continue on. We have a few little things to touch up. And finally, now that I've got you through 1,000 years of church history, I'm going to go back and we're going to look at it in light of Thyatira. And we're going to say, when Jesus said all these things to Thyatira, was some of this stuff that happened in that 1,000 years relevant or pertinent to what Jesus said to the church at Thyatira? When you guys see the big picture of why I brought you all the way through, I think some of your minds are going to be blown, because mine was. Okay.
Go back and read it right now. And read that letter right now, and your jaw should hit the ground.
Right. So anyways, we'll pray and get out of here. I see Pastor back there hovering like a vulture, so I'm probably going to get in trouble. All right. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we get to study human history. We thank you because, Lord, we know that we don't have to allow history to repeat itself. We can pray, God. We can pray for spiritual revival. We can pray for spiritual strength. We can pray that people would wake up and see that we have freedoms unprecedented in human history. And if the church will wake up and begin to pray, we know, God, that you will supernaturally protect us and you will supernaturally empower us, God. I pray that you would raise up this church. I pray that you would continue to give us spiritual power to fight the enemy and to fight the darkness that is going over the whole world, God, and we know that you can. We pray that you prepare our hearts for whatever you have to speak to us today, God. Speak through Pastor today. Teach us, guide us. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you've enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.